There we go. Okay. In the name of the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Tonight we've got Peter Saad. For those who... Anyone not know Peter Saad? Do I need to introduce Peter Saad?
Just let it go.
Okay, we're just going to let it go. For those who don't know Peter Saad, I don't know where you guys have been living, but we've got Peter Saad, and he is giving a talk on moral relativism, the facade of tolerance. I don't know what that means, so I'm going to let you take it.
So, you don't know what it means. We'll figure it out together. So, how's everyone doing? Yeah, people are good. How many of you feel the world's on fire? You know, just a little bit. And I wasn't meaning churches literally, because that's a whole other thing. So let me ask you this question. How many of you agree with this statement? Our world markets itself, or today the theme in the world is this. You live your way, I live my way. And we all live together. Is that a fair statement? Do you guys think that's what it is? What do you think? Yes.
I add something.
Okay. So it's exactly right, right? But you don't hear that second part announced. We speak to each other in this alternative reality where we say, you be you and I be me. But there's a but, right? There always is a but. And what's the but? So long as I'm okay with how you're living, right? How many of us in this world today feel that Christian living is this widely accepted, it's almost as if there's a clear lane for us to coexist. My experience, not so much. It's getting narrower. So today I want to really focus on moral relativism and the idea of, is it possible for us to all just coexist, for all of us to kind of be in our own way? But to get there, we need to sort of understand what this parameter or sphere is we're talking about. So let's start first with morality. What is morality?
Values.
Say that again?
Values.
Values, okay.
Right versus wrong.
Right versus wrong?
It's a measurement as if it's morals.
For sure. So it's principles, it's values. And it's really an assessment of right and wrong. That's morality. And what does relativism, or to be relative, mean?
Absolutely.
In relation to something.
In relation to something. Joe said no absolutes. What do you guys think?
Perspective.
Perspective? So it really is this doctrine. It's defined as knowledge, truth, morality, and they exist in correlation to society, to values of the mainstream. And really, historical context, so it's the human experience, and there's no absolutes. You combine them together, and the theory is, the prevailing philosophy of our day teaches that there is no absolute truth, and that all philosophies, all religions, all opinions are equally valid, with no way to distinguish one as being morally superior to others. And it's also named... It's also known by the name of tolerance. So I'm going to walk you through how we got here, okay? The first point is the pre-modern world understood reality in terms of the supernatural. And that is everything owed its existence and meaning to a spiritual realm beyond our control. Then we entered the modern world, and this was the result of enlightenment. And this was a time when rationalization was at its peak. It brought us modern science, conveniences, cars, you know, Ford brothers, the Wright brothers with the airplanes. But it also brought about the repercussions of who remembers the working conditions. And we spoke about this, or we learned about this in history, where work conditions were absolutely intolerable and unfair. There was slavery, the advance to communism, Nazi Germany, a Great Depression, something we have never seen. And then today we have environmental fears, global warming, different ailments. So we left that behind, and now we live in a postmodern world. And this one, people wanted to correct that modern era. And the outlook on life changed. So it produced a reaction to a question most underpinning the modern era, and that is that almost universal assumption has become practically universal in our society today, and based on that assumption, people interpret reality in a way never thought before. You know what it is? It's our interpretation of what is true. Is truth absolute, or is truth relative?
Truth is absolute.
Depends who you ask.
Sorry?
Depends who you ask.
So Joe says truth is absolute. Aki says it depends who you ask. Friedrich Nietzsche said, "You have your way, I have my way. As for the right way, it does not exist." So his thoughts truly summarizes the postmodern world that we live in. Why do you think we got here? Relativism is so polite, right? I don't have to do anything, I don't have to tell you anything. But because there's no absolutes anymore, it's impotent, it's powerless. Truth is no longer truth as you actually once knew it to be. And if truth is relative, then whose experience should prevail? Some say truth is contemplated, like Plato. Some say, like Aristotle, truth is reasoned. Some say truth is variable. You guys might be too young, but the famous Bill Clinton line during his impeachment trial when he said, that depends on what that definition of is is. And some say truth is subconscious, like Freud. And finally, some say truth is your perception. We often hear this phrase, it might be true for you, but it's not true for me. And as a result, truth is seen as this personal experience or personal preference and a perception. So if truth is dependent on one person's experience, then it has to be ever-changing. Because we evolve. As children, we had very different perspectives on reality and our limitations physically versus what we can actually engage in or do today. So take some examples for you, and you'll see how quickly this theory collapses. Suppose your pharmacist was a relativist. And a doctor writes a script for a heart medication. And you go to the pharmacy, and you give the prescription. The pharmacist says, all medicine are the same. I'm not going to give you heart medicine, I'm going to give you the medicine I so choose. What's going to happen to that patient?
That doesn't make any sense, because the medication will react differently to the body.
So then, in that circumstance, can truth be relative?
No.
Another example, and this is an important one. We all lived through this one. 2007, 2008, the world ended economically.
It ended today too.
Yeah, seriously. We thought that was bad back then, right? But the world was challenged economically. There was a crisis. And all the professors and all sort of the ideologues that were teaching in faculties and universities about business ethics, they proceeded to benefit off of this demise, off of this decline.
theoretical absolutes or framing issues in a certain way, once challenged or once presented with the opportunity, we react very differently. You know, you're told in business ethics, don't take risks, don't do this, don't do that. Corporate governance, you know, social responsibility, all these things. The very companies that were advocating all these things in marketing materials took the economy to the brink by doing what? By selling products to people who could not afford these products. I'll never forget this. I was in New York the summer of 2006. And the TV commercials would say stuff like this. Own a house with no money. And what ended up happening is you would sign the papers and buy a house. And all you have to do is make your monthly payment. So now the house is worth $100 and your mortgage is $100. No one ever spoke about the fact that maybe the house is worth 98, not 100. And it created this immense bubble. The subprime mortgage is something you would... And the sad reality is it was vulture financing by the same institutions that would put themselves out as the high moral compass. So the type of reaction speaks loudly that there is importance to truth. Moral relativists have a rather dim view when it negatively impacts them. Recently I saw a video where someone was challenging a speaker about white privilege. And the person was white and he was standing and he says, you know, I'm a beneficiary of white privilege, but society must, you know, make restitution and right the historical wrongs. You hear what he said very subtly? He didn't say, I need to make restitution because I got ahead. He said, society. In that moment, it is very convenient to be a relativist as long as it doesn't infringe on you. Archbishop Desmond Tutu said, if you are neutral in situations of injustice, you have chosen the side of the oppressor. If an elephant has his foot on the tail of a mouse and you say that they are neutral, the mouse will not appreciate your neutrality. Imagine that. So then you go and say, well, if truth is relative, then all spiritual truth is valid. And this means that all religions and philosophies carry the exact same weight. Whether it's Christianity, Buddhism, Judaism, atheism, Islam, everyone collectively is entitled to the relative truth. This sounds really nice, right? It just makes us feel comfortable because we don't have to take a position. So why can't we just all get along and exist cohesively? Let me answer this, right? What do you do with spiritual truths that are mutually exclusive? Example, Jesus claimed to be the only true God, that no one can come to the Father except through him. Other religions have many gods. Or Islam says, or even Judaism says, Jesus isn't God. So how can that all be true? Reality is, they can't. Especially when you make claims of exclusivity. The general claims you can actually probably coexist, but the exclusive claims you can't. Islam declares that Israel should be destroyed. Pacifism would reject that, right? That's a thought, that's a philosophy. So which is right and why? Why should I listen to your religion or your philosophy, even if it means Why should I listen to your philosophy or religion and assume it as valid, even if it means I have moral freedom and maybe even a moral obligation to kill you as an infidel? You cannot have mutually exclusive viewpoints on issues because one must be right and one must be wrong. So the next implication of relativism is that persuasion is not allowed, tolerance is king. I have found people that are proud of their tolerance and angry when their perceived attitudes of judgment in others. Here's a problem. If you're as tolerant as you claim you are, you have no right to judge my position. Because you can't say anyone else is invalid. Anyone else's position is invalid. My Christianity must be accepted by you as being valid, a valid viewpoint, if you are going to be consistent in your observance of tolerance. I rarely agree with Bill Maher. Even Bill Maher has a problem with political correctness, right? Unfortunately, this relativism, or this idea of no absolute truth, is great in theory, but in reality it's a one-way street. And it runs away from Christianity. They want Christianity to be malleable, to change, to evolve. But everyone else is allowed to have those, you know, let's call it the safe spaces. So there's no moral absolutes is another one. And the usual context of this is that no one can make moral judgments on someone else's lifestyle choices. First of all, let me tell you that I found absolutely no one who doesn't make moral judgments all the time. I might judge and it be wrong. You might judge and it be okay. It doesn't work. They're both moral judgments. We're making judgments and discernments and decisions all the time in our lives. So let's take this even to an extreme step on this idea of moral relativism. If you truly are tolerant and you truly are guided by this virtue of tolerance and there's no moral absolutes, then Hitler was fine, Charles Manson was fine, racism, rape, murder, they're all acceptable because in that thought process, they perceived it to be okay. How many of us live in that world? How many of us live in that world where society generally will accept these, what we want to call, whatever you want to call Hitler's conduct or Charles Manson or sex crimes or whatever, as morally tolerant? How many people in society would accept that? Very few. I will say that there will always be a fringe. But generally speaking, the same people who preach tolerance would say, no, Hitler couldn't do that. Or no, that person shouldn't have done that. But if you are tolerant, you couldn't have made that statement to actually make a judgment. Because now, you're assuming that there is a true truth. An absolute truth. Not one that is relative. Because I can assess it as it impacts my actions, impacts my life based on your actions. Look, in reality, truth is absolute. Because without a moral code, without a right and wrong, it truly would be a free-for-all for everybody. We live with rules of engagement. That's what we live with. We also know if I do A, the consequence is B. We're guided by these in sort of our day-to-day living. And the important question is, why do people reject absolute truth? Why do you think?
It might not be convenient for them.
Sorry?
It might not be convenient for them.
Might not be convenient for them. Fair. What else?
Not the majority opinion.
Oh, man. Not the majority opinion, for sure. Who said earlier it's polite? It's easier, right? It's easier not to voice your opinion. It's easier to just let's all coexist, right? And before you think I'm telling you to go on a crusade with, pitchforks, we'll get to how we need to respond from a Christian perspective. So let's explore what Christian truth absolutely is. So we as Christians believe in Christian truth, and it doesn't necessarily mean it is all easily understood. There's an element in our lives that is faith-based. And you know something? Truth has so biblically found, it's funny, one of the greatest verses in the Bible about truth is, Pilate says in John 18:38, what does he say? When he's confronted with Jesus, he says, what is truth? So Pilate was on this lifelong journey to uncover what truth was. The truth, no pun intended, a lot of references to truth, but the reality is, Christian beliefs and biblical teachings will often put us at odds with the world. And every day, even more so. It's only difficult also because the thoughts of tolerance and we are all one mindsets. You know, I hope that the discussion today at least gets you to think and say, you know, are we really all one? Because if we are, then I should feel so safe to say my views and to live my life without fear of cancel culture, without fear of retribution, without fear of condemnation. This pandemic has been truly eye-opening. And it's been eye-opening in so many facets of our lives. Something as simple as, you know, the journey about the vaccine. Is the vaccine safe? Is the vaccine unsafe? Masks work, masks don't work. You see the herd mentality? Even doctors are fearful to give alternative hypothesis about maybe a different thought to some, you know, process or some aspect of this pandemic. Why? Immediately, what happens? I don't think it's criticism. I think it's ostracized. It's complaints to your medical college for endangering. Wait, I thought we lived in a space where you be you and I be me. Reality is it isn't. It's you have to be me. Right? So truth is defined as it has to be something objective. And Joe said this. It has to be consistent. It has to be constant. And that's actually really what makes biblical truth so powerful. Christ truly has always been consistent. God's love for us from the onset of creation to present was what? When Adam needed something in the garden, God was there to fulfill his need. When we went astray, Christ gave himself on the cross. He's always there side by side with us. And that is a constant truth. Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 15:58 says, "Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourselves fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." Our steadfastness in faith is so important in what we do in our day-to-day living. And look, there's a huge difference in what we believe versus what the world believes. The Bible and Christ, especially in the Gospels, it was really powerful, right? Because Christ knows we like pictures, you know? It's a lot more exciting when a Buddha or a speaker has a PowerPoint presentation or something instead of them being boring like me and just standing here and talking, right? We like pictures. So what did Christ say to them? He said, "There's a really wide gate and a really narrow gate. Guess what? Which one are you going to enter from?" The really narrow gate. So the theater was there. The imagery was there. And he never misled us. Because I actually feel like the gate's getting narrower. I don't even know if it's a gate anymore. It's like almost a window when you look around us a bit these days. The world bases what they believe a lot of times on emotions or flat-out falsehoods, shifting morals and ethics. Morality has shifted. Ethics has shifted. You see, flexibility in our faith creates a lack of seriousness and a lack of appreciation of others. 2 Timothy 4:3-5 says, "For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. But you keep your head in all situations, endure hardships, do the work of an evangelist, discharge all the duties of your ministry." There's a story of Abraham Lincoln. And I read, and he met a general named General McClellan. I don't know who he is, but it's an interesting story anyways. So he asked the general, "How many legs does a horse have if you call the tail a leg?" So McClellan answered, and he said, 5. Lincoln replied, "It's 4. Merely calling a tail a leg doesn't make it one." We face the same effect today regarding Scripture. Merely calling something biblical and trying to twist the Word of God to appease or to sort of assuage the herd mentality. How do you think society responds if you give a millimeter? Have you satisfied the beast? Again, no pun intended, sir. More than ever, false prophets rise each and every day. There are so many people who pretend and preach what they think, I don't know if they think it, but what they want to think, the Bible says. What is cooler than a preacher being the hip, tolerant one who ignores Leviticus in its entirety and somehow finds the sexuality and all the different sins that were around and says, you know, "Oh, it's okay. God loves us." The truth is, God does love us. And the truth is, we all have sinned and fallen short of the kingdom. But the Bible still says, this is a sin, that is a sin. That doesn't change God's love. So this flexibility creates truly a lack of seriousness. And it's not truth. So I asked Aki to prepare a clip for me. And we'll just play it and then we'll go into it a bit further. It's from the movie A Few Good Men. We're just loading it, just one sec. It was. The suspense is building. It's okay if it doesn't work. We're going to get to it. Okay. So we're going to wait for the clip, but as we wait for the clip, the world doesn't want.
Where are you going?
The world doesn't want to deal in truth. We talked about this. You know, we were talking about relativism. Imagine we all show up at a traffic light. And red for you means go, and green for me means stop. It's my truth, and it's his truth. And we all follow our own truth system. What's going to happen?
Accidents.
Chaos. Right? You know in cartoons when you see like a character take over like the train circuits and all the trains start going haywire? Right? But that's what the world wants us to believe in as we're living through.
It's okay, Aki.
You're going to make it work. Aki's determined. So at the end of this, you guys are going to have questions or no? That one's a bit longer. It's okay, don't worry. Don't worry about it. So you guys know the theme in A Few Good Men. And Tom Cruise asks Colonel Jessup, Jack Nicholson, he says to him, "Do you want the truth?" And he says, "I demand it." And he responds, "You can't handle the truth." This was the most anticlimactic way of doing it, as they were screaming at each other in the movie.
Thanks, Aki.
But no, all kidding is...
It's okay, I'm just joking.
But all seriousness, Christ doesn't conceal the truth from us. He tells us the truth. He wants us to own the truth. He trusts us with the truth. John 8:31-32, so Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Look, the Christian truth is absolute, and we see it in Revelations. So Revelations 2:18-28, God spoke to the church of Thyatira, which was known as the tolerant church. I'll read a part of it, chapter 2:18-21. Oh, don't worry, it's okay.
Do you want to just play it loud?
"I know your deeds, your love and faith, your service and perseverance, and that you are now doing more than you did first. Nevertheless, I have this against you.
You tolerate that woman, Jezebel, who calls herself a prophet. By her teaching, she misleads my servants into sexual immorality and the eating of food sacrificed to idols. I have given her time to repent of her immorality, but she is unwilling. So I will cast her on a bed of suffering, and I will make those who commit adultery with her suffer intensely, unless they repent of her ways. I will strike her children dead. Then all the churches will know that I am he who searches hearts and minds, and I will repay each of you according to your deeds. So Christ, or in Revelation, God says, hey, congratulations, you've done a lot of great things. But you're doing miserable things too. You've allowed this person, Jezebel, to be in your midst, to breed false teachings. And Jezebel was from the Old Testament. We know the name from the Old Testament, and she was one of the evil women in the Old Testament. She's found in the book of Kings, 1 Kings. So she not only worshipped false gods, she was a murderer, and she seemed to make it her life's goal to destroy the religion of Israel. She also followed a religion with unbridled sexual immorality. So in the church of Thyatira, they were doing all these things great, and God acknowledges that. But sometimes the pressure of fitting in with the world is overwhelming, and we fail to take a firm stand in our faith. And that's where trust, that's where that bridge of trust has to kick in. If you actually evaluate your belief system in every moment of time, intellect, knowledge, human capacity takes you so far. But it is that last step that is what? What's that last step in your journey? Faith. When you're driving a car, and you get to those traffic lights we talked about, logically, you have determined that humanity is following a rule system. You're pressing on the gas when it is green. Why? Do you have absolute certainty that there isn't someone who's going to break that red light? You don't. In that moment, you are trusting. You are taking that leap of faith in a very small example in our lives. There are no coincidences in life. So in that moment, you have to make that determination to trust. So we have to make that determination too in our lives. When we decide to stand for truth, we can be like Moses was. God will give you an errand to speak on your behalf. So how can I live in this world today? I'll give you an illustration to consider. So a woman stands before a judge and a jury and places one hand on the Bible and the other in the air and makes a pledge. For the next few minutes, she will tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help her God. She's a witness. And her job there is not to expand her duties. Her job is simply to answer the questions she is asked with in truth. Then she leaves it to the lawyers to determine and try to spin it. Back to relativism, to try to spin the truth. But for the witness, she's only asked to speak the truth. If she does more or less, she gets in trouble. So the Christian too is a witness. And we too make a pledge. And like that witness, we are called to always witness to the truth. Look, the bench may be absent, but the judge is present. And so is the jury. The jury is society who is watching your every move and every statement that you make in your day-to-day living. Acts 1:8 says, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." So we're all witnesses, and we're all witnesses in the court of life. And we're all called to testify to the truth. Our task is not to whitewash or to lie or to sugarcoat. We just say the truth. But how we say it is important, and we'll discuss that in a minute. There is one difference between the witness in court and the witness in life. Eventually, that lady will step down from the witness box, and her job is finished. With us, we never step down. From the moment we are baptized to the moment we leave this earth, we are witnesses. In our world today, the claims of Christ are always on trial, and the court is perpetually in session, and we always remain watchful and under oath. So then, how do I respond in this world where people want to drown me out? People find the truth inconvenient. Look, the first thing is we can focus on something we all will agree on, which is harm reduction. Who knows what that is, or who can think of what that is?
Try to reduce the least harm, reduce the less casualties to the person.
So you're trying to reduce the least harm. You know, when you think about harm reduction, 1 Corinthians 10:23 stands out where it says, "I have a right to do anything, you say, but not everything is beneficial. I have the right to do anything, but not everything is constructive." I think that's a pretty fair sentence. And I think that spirit can be something we use to bridge.
All of us are watching the residential school issue, and all of us are sitting and watching and wondering, you know, churches are getting burnt, and this reaction, that reaction.
And we talked about emotional reactions earlier, right? But when you pause and think about exactly what is going on, ask yourself this question. Are those churches getting burned as a rejection of Christ? Is it possible that this conflict is one of blame shifting between a government and institutions who were both equally responsible for what was taking place at the time? And you have to ask yourself the question about this. Nothing hurts any of us than thinking about taking someone out of their home to make them normal, or I'm always guided by what Gandhi said when he said, "An eye for an eye will make the whole world blind." So a wrong happened, and it did. But burning down churches, when you think about courts, many a times have people been prosecuted falsely. Prejudicial juries, racist juries. We can't go burn down the courts. We have to always look at things from this broader angle of harm reduction. Because we can talk about a lot of social issues,
We can talk about drugs. We can talk about sexual impurity. We can talk of, you know, lack of faithfulness in marriage. Beyond the humanistic pleasure, is there emotional baggage that comes with it?
Yes.
When you actually create a dependency on drugs, is that really a constructive way? Is that a healthy way for you to live?
No.
Now, it's very different for me to have that discussion and try to reason with you on the greater good than to say, oh, you are a sinner. I would never do what you just did. But in reality, I do that and 10 times more every day in my walk of life. The tone we speak is the second most important thing for me. Ephesians 4:15 says instead, speaking the truth in love. Speak the truth in love. Doesn't say condemn. We will grow to become in every aspect, in every respect, the measure body of him who is the head, that is Christ. You've heard, love the sinner, hate the sin. I would tell you, love the sinner, pray to cure the sin. I feel like we aren't capable of understanding how to respectfully hate. The oxymoron that is, right? Because we think the way to be heard is to condemn, is to reject. In our simplistic human mind, we have created, you know, like Maslow's hierarchy of needs? We have a hierarchy of sins. And some sins get a lot worse points than others in our minds. Go back to Sunday school in JK when they say, you know, the white lie. A lie is a lie. We're so quick to pick and choose which sins we must make a stink of it. And the louder we go, do you think people listen? The louder you scream, the less people hear. And Christians, unfortunately, Christianity, unfortunately, we have a victim complex. We sometimes are very reactionary. We're always kind of waiting and just sitting quietly. Yes, I'm a Christian and I exist. But then the second something negative happens, I'm outraged about it. But what have you done with your Christian faith to share it, to spread it, to live it? Are you truly a vehicle for the promotion of biblical truth? Or are you just a Christian name? You think about all the movements that have risen around us. You think about LGBTQ and pride. How strong that movement has become, and how heard that voice has become. I'm not really hearing much about us these days. What I do hear, however, is we're very good at critiquing the church and critiquing the service and critiquing whatever it is we're not fond of. You know the saying, who needs enemies when you have friends like these? Sometimes we're the ones who are truly the people throwing the matches at the churches.
Or maybe we put the gasoline and someone just needs to bring the match. Finally, don't be ashamed of the absolute truth. In 2 Timothy, Paul warns his young friends to not be ashamed to preach the gospel. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. I read this as in season and out of season. In season is in the safe confines of the church. Here we are, a bunch of, you know, we're in a safe space, so we can talk a certain way. But that's the easy part. Now, I'm not telling you, like I said earlier, pitchforks, so now I'm not telling you to Bible thump either. Just be consistent in who you are. Be consistent as a child, a daughter or son of God. How does God want us to live? I'm going to conclude with this saying, a man's influence works two ways, positively or negatively, never neutrally. The person who doesn't take a stand for Christ is taking a stand against him. Thoughts, questions. Disagree, agree. Yes. Can I ask you to speak up a little bit? I heard most of it. So you said at the beginning, trying to convince me, you know what, let me give you the mic. So you're saying that there are certain subjects where most people will agree, right is right, wrong is wrong. And there are others where people, you know, are less inclined to agree, and why not just kind of leave it to be? Okay. Good question. So I don't know if you were here at the beginning when I said, The problem is, the example I gave was this. You go to your pharmacist, you have a script for a heart medicine. The pharmacist says, medicine is medicine. I'm not going to give you heart medicine, I'm going to give you whatever, a diabetes medicine. Right? It can't work that way. And even on murder, let's talk about abortion. Because you're saying, generally speaking, people agree. I'm going to say when you actually get granular, people don't agree. Why? Let's talk about abortion or assisted suicide. Some will view that as murder. Some will view that as murder. Other will view that as choice. Some will tell you it's a fetus. It's not a human. Therefore, it's not murder. A really crazy story, and I'll come back to the sexuality one. State of Florida, I'll never forget this case. The wife's name was Casey Anthony. Probably was in 2000 maybe, 2003. And the husband, I think, no, not Casey Anthony, sorry, the husband's name was Scott Peterson. He killed his wife who was pregnant. How many charges of murder did he get charged with? Two. But had she aborted the child, it wouldn't have been murder. How could those, both of those be true? Right? Now, personal choice, sexuality, drugs, intoxication, whatever it is you kind of feel that urge to act upon. You either accept the moral code of the Bible and say, this is my truth, we may not be able to agree on the issue. And you might say, okay, but can't we just all coexist? The problem is this. Personal choice is one thing. Because, didn't I just say, all sin is sin? I don't have that hierarchy of sin. If my fall from grace is X versus your Y, fine. But does it stop there? In your experience, does it stop there with it being an issue of personal choice? What do you think? Who refused to bake a cake for a same-sex marriage. And that case went all the way to the Supreme Court of the United States. Did the personal choice end at that one person, or did it impact another person? We like to package things as I'll be me and you be you. But it doesn't stop. Right? Something as simple also, but as a church and as Christians, what did I say about the pitchfork? Put them away. When the discussion of same-sex marriage erupted under John Kirchner years ago, what happened? How did we react? We as the body, Christians in general, how did we react? With open arms and love and no. We had our pitchforks out. But we didn't understand what the issue was. Do you understand what the issue actually was about same-sex marriage? And I know I'm gonna get in trouble after all this, but the Buddha will absolve me. The issue was actually a protection of rights, and I'll explain to you what it means. If I go and get married civilly, I'm under what's called the Family Law Act. And if I chose, me and a partner, female, chose not to get married civilly, the court would say, you have chosen to cohabit and to not be subject to the protection of matrimony. And therefore, there isn't spousal benefits, there isn't this, you know, equalization of assets on the breakdown of the relationship. So there was no place in the law for a homosexual couple to voluntarily fall under the Family Law Act. So if a couple lived together for 30 years and one person sacrificed their career for the benefit of the other and the relationship broke down, what happened? Tough luck. There's no support. So the government essentially modified the definition to allow both homosexual and heterosexual couples to fall under the Family Law Act. But this is where personal choice and relativism gets annoying, to put it lightly. Civil union could have been the defined term, but no, it had to be marriage. So the one side insisted on marriage, and the other side insisted on no protection under the law. And it became this very toxic issue that if cooler heads prevailed, harm reduction, tone, we could have amicably all fixed that one. Abortion. So I'm a big pro-life person. But I also understand why there needs to be a legal mechanism for abortion, harm reduction. Marijuana was legalized. Again, not everything that is legal is constructive for me. The issue becomes is it doesn't stop there. It goes further. And it goes to impose restrictions on you as a Christian for being able to speak to anybody about these issues, referencing choice. And that's where we're moving. That's why this "we all love" attitude, I would say yes, we do all love. But you've got to love me too. It's not a one-way street. No relationship works, and no society will be cohesive when you're constantly fragmenting and segmenting and dividing. So the defense of personal choice is convenient, but it never stops there. And we need to have a cohesive society that is able for you to express that you view homosexuality as a sin, and to be able to say those words without fear of condemnation, without fear of retribution. And that's where we need to be able to be respectfully vocal. I went on a tangent, I'm sorry. But what do you think?
I think it's hard so you're saying that the moral relativism makes it seem like we're accepting everyone, but in the end, actually, we're criticizing.
No. Moral relativism means you accept me and I accept you. What I'm telling you is, in my experience, and in the experiences I've shared with you today, it seems like it's a one-way acceptance. It's my way or the highway. And that's where it breaks down, right? And that's the whole point of this. Because if it was truly cohesive, we both can't have truth on our side. right? And that's the fundamental issue. And guys, my warning or my hope today is to say, be careful what door you're opening. Be careful what door you're opening. Because you can't control the close of labor. Guys, the reality is there's a silent majority on every issue. There is a silent majority on every issue. Who agrees or disagrees with that sentence?
What do you mean by silent majority?
What I mean, Joe, is there are a lot of people who agree or disagree on an issue and just either are apathetic, indifferent, because they just don't want to get into the middle of it. It's usually the minority on each side. Trust me, look up Westboro Church. I gave you guys a lot of homework today. Look up Westboro Church. They would go to military funerals in the U.S. with signs saying, it was homophobic signs, essentially, these people are dead because God hates homosexuals. Please find in the Bible where that matches the Christ who died on the cross for everyone. You can't. But those people are doing it in the name of Christianity. False prophets. And the false prophets may come up on both sides of the issue. Intolerance and convenient tolerance. Imagine how powerful we would be if each of us spoke truth. And guys, you know, I spoke about Moses earlier. God said, Moses, go liberate the people from Israel, from Egypt, right? Sorry. Get them out of Egypt. God knew Moses' capacity. He knew he couldn't speak. But what did he do? He said, take Aaron with you. He'll do the talking. We each have a role. Don't be a closet Christian. But also, don't be a zealot. Just be normal. Be consistent.
All right, guys. So, you know, having done youth service for a long time, I've seen a lot of things happen. And when somebody's neutral and basically trying to be in the middle when it comes to really important subjects in, you know, in not just for good Coptic Orthodoxy, in Christianity period, then what happens is the devil uses it as an opportunity to kind of pull people to one side, away from God. And I think, you know, that's what moral, you know, being morally relative means, is that, you know, you're trying to be neutral, you're trying to be in the middle, trying not to pick a side. And what I've seen is really, like, really, you know, the devil uses it to pull people aside. So, you know, when St. Peter says, you know, the devil walks around with a roaring lion waiting to snatch you, it's really because he's waiting for an opportunity to just take us away from God. And being neutral in anything, I've seen it pull people away from the church and away from God, because we're trying to be neutral and too accepting without, you know, being firm in the way of God. And I think it's really important to kind of make sure that we're really aware of that. You know, and not being pulled away, because eventually everybody gets so far away, they leave the church and they leave Christianity, period.
Wishy-washy faith is like no faith, right? Someone once said to me about decision-making. They said, if you choose not to make you're presented with options, and you choose not to make to pick one of the options. Don't think for a second you didn't make a decision. You actually did. You decided to accept status quo of do nothing. Joel Osteen, interesting guy. Prosperity gospel galore, right? When Proposition 8 was on the ballot in the state of California, they had Joel Osteen on CNN and they said, so what are your thoughts? Proposition 8 was, I don't know if it was same-sex marriage or it was something related to homosexuality. And so they asked him, what are your thoughts? And in the interest of not offending anybody, he offended everybody. He squirmed around that question and he couldn't answer it in any conclusive way. He couldn't. So the non-Christian community says, you know, you're not bold enough to show, you know, love for us. And the Christian community said, the Bible says X is a sin. He lost both sides of that argument. And then he went back on CNN later and he's like, I was misunderstood. The Bible is pretty clear and I'm guided by the Bible. Tonight I've really mentioned homosexuality multiple times. Honestly, we sometimes really fixate on issues. Because let's talk about whatever your sort of date with the devil is. Premarital sex, pornography, lying, jealousy, anything. I hope today you leave with one thing only. Get rid of that hierarchy of sin mindset. We all need God's mercy. Every single one of us. Don't keep a scorecard saying, well, today I only did a few small sins. Because you guys know death by 1,000 paper cuts? Still kills you. Thoughts? Anyone else? We have a message of hope, and regardless of how things look and feel, God is in control, and we sleep, and we will rise tomorrow, and the sun will rise. Yes?
So like it's often, I hear like, can't have absolutes like in society where there's no absolutes. What do you think about that? Because I know the other side is saying that, well, that in itself is an absolute, to say that there's no absolutes. I just wanted to get your thoughts on that.
So give me one sec, because I just want to look. So I'll give you this, I was just trying to remember in my notes where it was. It is convenient to say there's no absolutes, so we can all exist, you know, happily. But let's talk about sort of religion, just let's use religion simplistically. We believe that God is the one and only true God. Islam doesn't. Judaism rejects the Messiah, Christ. The Asian, whether it's Buddhism or Hinduism, many gods.
who's right. It's convenient. We feel comfortable saying, it's okay, we all. But when we have an exclusive faith, we believe that God is absolute. We believe that there's only one true God. Everything breaks down. So as a society, what we need to do is to sit and say, well, this is why I believe my God is the one true God. I'm not going to beat a book over your head, but this is the truth. They're going to counter and say, no, this is the truth. But those are the conversations to flesh out what absolute truth is. It is... You go further and you think of a religion like Islam that advocates for the unfaithful infidels to not be worthy to live. If they act on that, what happens? They will trump her point about most people can agree around murder. But here you're presented with yet another variable to shift the conversation to say, well, wait, we all said murder is wrong, but you're saying, but you're an infidel and you can't be. And that's where you need to have these discussions, because we can't all be right. I don't know, what do you think? Like, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, no, I think that there definitely is that